Red Ribbon Week. This is to inform students on the consequences of using drugs. October 31st through November 4th is our big Homecoming Spirit Week. This is to promote the Homecoming Dance, which is on Saturday. We will have a top six rally, so that is the top six court. And on Friday, we'll have our big blue and gold assembly showcasing the top six and getting the students united and excited for the dance. And November 7th, we will have our monthly senior event, which is the senior recreation night. It includes jumpers, inflatables, foosball, and air hockey tables. And next month, November 14th, we'll have our class meetings and House of Representatives meetings. So students from all classes are able to join the meeting and provide constructive criticism and get notified about upcoming events. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we'll go into our staff report on nutrition services presentation. And Dr. Mitchell.
Thank you very much. So this is in response to an interest that the board has expressed to learn a little bit more about our nutrition services department, but also to learn about the opportunity to provide universal breakfast. And so Maria Davila, who is our director of nutrition services, is here this afternoon to be able to share with the board a little bit of background. There is no action for this item tonight. This is information only. And should it be at the pleasure of the board, we would put an action item on our November board agenda. Maria?
Good evening, everyone.
The lights right there.
I got it. Good evening, everyone. I'm here to provide a very brief overview of the Nutrition Services Program as well as Universal Breakfast. So who are we? Nutrition Services is a self-funded program that operates with minimal impact on the general fund. The majority of Nutrition Services revenue is from state and federal meal reimbursements, as well as from non-program food sales, including catering and a la carte foods. In recent years, child nutrition programs in schools have seen dramatic changes in meal requirements, beginning with food items sold outside of the reimbursable meal programs, and more recently within the meal programs as part of the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act. Some of the major changes include tighter restrictions on calories, fat, saturated fat, and trans fat, as well as the replacement of refined breads to whole grains. The programs continue to work through ongoing sodium restrictions, with the next phase of restrictions coming through in July 2017. Finally, one of the biggest challenges is the mandatory fruit and vegetable requirement. All students must take at least half a cup of fruit or vegetable as they come through the serving line in order for the meal to be counted as reimbursable. Now I'll briefly go over this each meal program that we offer, beginning with the school breakfast program. This program is supported by both federal and state funding through meal reimbursements based on student participation. Breakfast is offered at most district sites, and all breakfast program meals must also meet new federal meal requirements. The daily breakfast menu includes an entree, and some of the students' favorites here at Roland are the beef sausage sandwich on a biscuit, French toast, and bagels with cream cheese. We find that students really like the hot meals, though some of them still prefer cereal every day. And because of this, we offer cold cereal at all school sites in addition to the main entree. So students can take both the entree and cereal, or just cereal if they prefer. We also offer fruit and milk. Another program offered by Nutrition Services is the National School Lunch Program. This program is also federally funded with both state and federal reimbursement based on student participation. In addition to providing cash reimbursement for meals served in schools, USDA supports child nutrition programs by providing USDA purchased food from American agricultural producers, and those are also known as commodity. For lunch, we offer the entree with student favorites including barbecue chicken, orange chicken, turkey gravy, and our most recent addition, which has turned into a favorite, are pork tamales. We also offer fresh fruit, including pre-cut fruit, which students tend to prefer, including kiwi fruit, sliced apples, watermelon spears, and pineapple spears. Fresh vegetables are offered daily in a variety of colors as part of the meal guidelines, with the newest additions being edamame and zucchini coins. One challenge for the meal program is to offer fruit and vegetables that are appealing to students that still meet meal pattern requirements. Sometimes we find that the students return to the salad bars, which is where we offer most of the variety of our choices for additional servings of their favorites. Our next program is the after-school meal supplements or SNAP program. Nutrition Services also participates in this program as part of the National School Lunch Program. We currently offer snacks to after-school programs at 10 of the district school sites. As part of this program, students must be enrolled in the after-school program in order to receive a snack, and the program must provide children with regularly scheduled enrichment activities. A sports or homework program would not qualify for after-school snacks. In addition, reimbursement is based on site eligibility, and students are not required to pay for their snacks. SNAP guidelines are less restrictive, though healthy snacks are a priority. We are able to choose from food items among the allowable food groups, grains, they must be whole grains, fruit or vegetable, meat or meat alternatives, and milk. In this table, we see meal participation numbers from the 15-16 school year. Taking the meal participation numbers for the entire school year, we see the daily averages for breakfast and lunch, separated by grade levels. Lunch participation rates are much higher than breakfast, and we see that on average more elementary age students participate in both programs. Based on our average enrollment for the 15-16 school year, approximately a quarter of enrolled students participated in breakfast, and approximately two-thirds of all enrolled students participated in lunch. Going back to breakfast, we find that after reviewing our breakfast counts for September 2016, which was our first full month of classes, we see that our average participation is slightly lower than the previous slide. We have only reviewed 1 month for this school year, but we may find that this number increases over the year as more students begin to participate. We also see that approximately 35% of students eligible for free or reduced price meals are participating in breakfast, and only 8% of students that are considered paid eligibility participate in school breakfast. Taking a look at the benefits of breakfast, there are multiple studies that show how starting the day off with a healthy breakfast is an important part after an evening of fasting. This is especially true for students. This study located at the nokidhungry.org website shows that students who eat breakfast achieve better scores and have fewer attendance and behavioral problems. It is one of the multiple studies that show an improved health outlook for students who eat breakfast, most especially a reduction in childhood obesity. So moving on to universal or no-cost breakfast. With universal breakfast, breakfast meals are available at no cost to all students, regardless of income or meal eligibility. Past studies have shown that schools that participate in universal breakfast experience an increase in student breakfast participation among all meal eligibilities. An increase in breakfast participation could lead to the health benefits associated with eating breakfast. How has universal breakfast been successful in schools in a way that increases breakfast participation? It requires work and attention of all district staff, including sufficient staff to monitor and oversee students as they arrive to eat breakfast. Students also need sufficient time to eat their meals. New programs are more successful with the proper amount of marketing and communication to families. In addition, appealing menu items that the students will want to eat will bring them in. As with most new programs, flexibility throughout the program is necessary to make changes when needed. This table shows the estimated costs associated with implementation of a universal breakfast program district-wide. The addition of breakfast supervision staff is a must, as more students will be expected on campus earlier in the morning. Again, program marketing in the form of banners and flyers, as well as by email, is critical for program success. With the anticipated increase in meal participation, food costs are expected to increase. Though increased reimbursements based on meal participation are expected to offset these costs. Currently, nutrition services breaks even when it comes to both labor and food costs. Also, there is currently a sufficient number of nutrition services staff at each site to support an increase in breakfast participation. There are a couple of points that are important to note. First, schools with greater than 70% of free or reduced price eligibility have been most successful. Those schools with less than this percentage have had successful universal breakfast programs. In addition, if operational costs exceed revenue, then the school district or general fund must make up the difference to the nonprofit school food service account or cafeteria fund. This means that if the numbers of students that are eligible for free or reduced price meals does not increase significantly, but the number of paid eligibility students that participate increases, there is a possibility that costs will exceed revenue. Pending board approval, Nutrition Services is seeking to pilot the Universal Breakfast Program at four school sites. Sites would include two elementary schools, one intermediate school, and one high school. The schools will be selected based on socioeconomic need, current breakfast participation, and site readiness, including staffing and meal times. Current meal times are sufficient to meet the needs of the current breakfast service. But if universal breakfast were to be implemented, it is expected that the participation counts would increase, which would also require an adjustment to school schedules to accommodate the increased number of students participating. In November 2016, the board will be asked to take action on implementation of this program. Pending board approval, Nutrition Services would work together with school site administration to determine the needs of each site. This would also be the time to review the menu and make necessary modifications, as well as to determine equipment needs, including sufficient meal transport equipment. December 2016 would be the time to focus on marketing of the program, including communicating to families about this program. Implementation of the Universal Breakfast Program would take place in January 2017. Collection of data, including participation rates, as well as cost versus revenue, would begin in January with a review every 3 months and an evaluation of all necessary data in May 2017. A report and recommendation to the board would be scheduled for June 2017. As always, Nutrition Services is committed to serving the students of Roland Unified School District and supporting the district's instruction and educational goals. Universal breakfast may be one way to improve student academic achievement. And that ends this presentation. What questions do you have for me?
Ms. Fraser?
You had said that the students need to eat some fruit and some vegetables. How do we have the kids do that for us to get reimbursed?
We participate in what's called offer versus serve. It's mandatory at all high school campuses, but it's optional at all other grade levels. But we participate at all grade levels to reduce food waste. Students are required to select half cup of fruit or vegetables. So as they come through the point of sale, their tray is checked to make sure that they have the appropriate number of components as part of the program and either half cup of fruit or vegetable.
And do we know which schools will be able to participate yet?
They're still under consideration.
Okay, thank you very much. Very great. Great report.
Mr. Malkin?
I have a comment. First of all, thank you very much for the report. I got interested in this almost a year ago now when I was down in San Diego at a conference. Districts that have done this. And you covered most of the stuff, the things that was covered at the conference. A couple other side issues is that we have a big problem with BMI among younger, you know, population. And along with that, you have diabetes and other healthcare issues. And they found that this has a big impact on the BMI of students that has resulted in better health and less incidences of childhood diabetes. So I think that's a big benefit on this. Also, about 2 months ago, I think it was, two or three board meetings ago, there was an item about billing and people that didn't load their cards or had overdue bills because of dietary. And there was a plan that was laid out of phone calls, letters, etc., to collect those bills. This eliminates that. Everybody that comes through gets the breakfast, and you don't have to worry about whether their card's loaded or not. So I think that's a big plus. And what I heard from a couple of other school districts when I was down in San Diego is that kids actually look forward to going to school in the morning to get the breakfast. And it becomes an item that they want. And it cuts down a lot of the resistance at home about getting kids ready to go to school because they look forward to that. As far as the fruit issue, one of our neighboring schools, they hooked up with a farmer's market. And they get all types of exotic fruits every day. And when they get the snacks out, they have an informational card related to the fruits that's in the box. And the kids get to pull a fruit out, whether it be a kiwi or a mango or whatever, and they're given an informational sheet about that fruit. So it becomes a game almost, and they really look forward to picking a fruit out every day that's different. So there's ways to, you know, make this not only nutritious, but also make it educational as far as nutrition is concerned. So I just think there's a lot of benefits in universal breakfast program. And I thank you for presenting this.
I have some questions about waste. Okay. Because I've been to several lunches at the various schools, and an awful lot of food is being thrown away now. Mm-hmm. If we're starting to feed every child, that'll increase the waste, and we need to figure out a way to solve that.
Currently, we do generate waste, and that has been a concern brought up by all school programs with the new meal guidelines, because they're so restrictive and we have to have a set amount of food on each tray. Also, part of you know, our training as dietitians is we encourage students not to clean their trays. To us, sometimes it's a positive when food that's left on the tray, because we encourage not to clean the tray. So it's also, the other thing is, students sometimes, we do taste tests to make sure that we're appealing to all the palatable students and what they want to eat. So we're constantly changing the menu, bringing on new items to avoid food waste. So, but with the fruit and vegetable, especially, we were working to find, you know, a better selection of food items.
Because I'm seeing milk, unopened milk being thrown away. I'm seeing sealed fruit and vegetables being thrown away that haven't even been touched.
And unfortunately, California code is very restrictive on what we can reuse. So, goodie tables were removed for a while, and now they're allowing us to bring it back, but technically, we're not even allowed to research something that has been put on the tray because it was counted as reimbursement. So it's very, it's kind of touchy, as well as serving seconds as part of the meal program. If we have leftover food items or part of the goodie box, we are not allowed to offer it to students because of the concerns with childhood obesity. So there, you know, the Cal Code is conflicting with, you know, the reimbursable meal program sometimes.
Going to ask you some tough questions, I'm sorry. Explain to me why, when families can afford to feed their kids, why the schools should be feeding them for free. They're paying taxes already. And the kids that deserve the food, the parents cannot afford it. I have no qualms about that, but I'm reluctant to think that we should give free meals out to every child.
In my experience with this program, I worked in two districts, two very large districts that had this program. And we found that the stigma associated with participating in the meal program. I was also a student that received free lunch in high school, and there was a stigma. When students see their peers also lining up to eat, it increases the participation, of the students who receive free and reduced. So we're really looking at increasing participation of those students, that 73% in this district, who are eligible and just don't eat and, you know, participate in breakfast. Right now we only have 35% of students.
What if we made food available to all students, but some pay and some don't, just like lunches?
That's a possibility. And we also implemented second chance breakfast at a couple of our school sites this year. So that did increase some participation, and we didn't offer universal. It was just an increased participation of all eligibilities.
I've seen a lot of kids have done it. I've seen the kids dump their food because of the taste. I asked them why they dump the food, but the taste is no good. And I understand the there's a the level of salt, the level of sugar. How we can improve that, the taste of the food?
Well, a lot of the food I like, but I like a lot of food. But you know, when we look at the meal program, we cannot purchase food that's in the freezer section at a supermarket. The pizza we serve has to be school pizza. It's got to be 100% whole grain. We have to serve rice and whole wheat bread. A lot of us don't even select that in the supermarket. Our sodium levels are so restricted, they're below clinical levels for someone with high blood pressure and kidney failure. So ultimately, we'll be below 700 milligrams at the end of when all the sodium restrictions phase in. So USDA is working with us to provide recipes. They're really pushing spices and things like that to replace fat and to include flavor when you're taking away calories and fat and sodium. The school nutrition associations are really saying exactly what you're saying. And when you can't remove flavor, we just need to everything in moderation. And so there's some back and forth with that. But I believe testing new recipes, testing with students, and developing groups with students, a taste test, and just keep working at it. That's how we improve flavor.
The question is we're living in a diversified community. There's a lot of the restriction of their culture, religious, and the sea pork. Some people don't eat pork, some people don't eat beef. And how do you handle it in regular basis? And if you offer beef and the kids don't eat beef, do you have alternate food provided to the kids?
We do. We are not required to modify menus, but we want our students to come in. So we've created a separate vegetarian menu for all school sites, as well as no pork. And then we modify menus based on food allergy, gluten-free, which is very trendy today. We have low sodium menus for students who are very restricted, and no peanuts. We modify a variety of menus, but for, you know, we do vegetarian and no pork.
Thank you.
Mr. Malkin? I just want to address a couple of things that Ms. Ebbekamp brought up. When I was checking out some of the universal meal programs, I found that the higher the grade level, the less participation of those that were getting a free meal versus those that were paying. And then when they introduced the universal, it went up across the board at all grade levels. And the assumption was is that as they got older, they became more aware that they were getting a free meal and other people weren't. And they didn't like the stigma associated with it, so they just didn't eat. And that stigma went away, like you said, once they did the universal. The other thing is, one of our neighboring districts, under certain conditions, depending on the food and where it's been, et cetera, has a program to divert food to New Horizons, which is a food bank. And they do that every day. Every day, food that's in excess of what they have goes to New Horizons, which is a food bank. That does two things. One, it provides food for people in the community that can't afford food for whatever reasons, but it also cuts down their organic waste. And that's one of the things that we're going to be under the pressure soon, is that we are going to have to reduce our organic waste or be penalized per pound for having additional waste. And one way to get rid to reduce that waste is to give the food to a food bank. There was some concern that was mentioned in the past about federal funding, but we found that that is not necessarily accurate, that you can give food to a food bank to reduce that organic waste.
Now, the question came up, or comment came up, about loading carts. The students would still have to load carts for lunch, right? So we would still have the same problem with as far as their payment for lunch, unless they were free or reduced lunch for free lunch for as well.
Right.
But the other students would still have to put money on their cards, right?
Right. They would have to still be able to pay for their lunch. Yeah.
And if you do pilot the program, how long do you anticipate you would need to pilot it in order to see how effective it was?
From January, from the last half of the school year, from January to June, we would look at everything and see how our numbers went, and I think that would be a sufficient amount of time.
Thank you. Any additional questions or comments? Ms. Evenkamp?
That question confused me. If we're talking about universal meals,
yes.
There's no charge to anybody, is there?
For universal breakfast, there would not be a charge, okay. But for lunch, we would still
continue the
charging.
Thank you.
Any additional questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we'll move to our public comments. First, we have Lanny Richardson.
Thank you for hearing me. I have a problem. I live on Killian Avenue.
I'm sorry, Mr. Richardson. I totally blew this. I forgot to read my statement before we started.
Okay.
It stay right there, but let me give you the rules for speaking. So don't leave. Written request to address the board. Remarks are limited to 3 minutes unless extended further or limited by vote of the board. A maximum of 20 minutes unless extended by the board is allocated for each subject discussed. Ordinarily, board members will not respond to presentations and no action can be taken. However, the board may give direction to staff following a presentation. So you have 3 minutes. So we're going to start the clock over. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't think it'll happen in 3 minutes, but my name is Lanny Richardson, and I live on Killian Avenue, right two houses down from the high school. We have a problem with the instrumental noise from the band and also from people practicing scales on the xylophone. It's a monotonous, ongoing scale that goes from this past weekend on Sunday. It started at 9 a.m. By 1 p.m. it was still going on. My wife went over to ask them if they could not do it on a Sunday, because it disrupts our weekend. We work during the week. We like to enjoy our weekends on our patio outside, and we can't do that because of the noise from the instruments. It echoes there in the courtyard, and it echoes and it comes right into our backyard. And so we've asked them to be quiet, and the man says, it's not my problem that you live here at school. I've called several times the superintendent's office over the years. Never received a call back. I spoke to somebody in your office, a secretary or somebody, and she said, well, I will have the superintendent call you back. Never heard from anybody. Same with the assistant principal. I called his office. Nobody ever called me back. And so that's why I'm here today. I would like to find out if they have to practice after 5 p.m. during the week, if they have to practice all weekend long and just disrupt my weekends, so I can't enjoy my company when I have company there because of the noise. We've asked them a few times. Even one time, the guy told us, why don't you move? Which was very rude. I've lived there for 39 years. Why should I move? I just would like to have something done about it. Either reschedule it where they could do it not at 7 o'clock at night, starting on weekdays, that's when they normally start, and not on the weekends. All weekend long, the same noise over and over again. I know they have to practice, and I know that they do it for a reason. They're marching bands and band competition and football games. That's fine, but not every weekend. And I just would like to request that something be done about it. And nothing has been done about it yet. And I would like to have something done. And if, you know, if I have to, I'll get a petition from the other people that live around the area. Because it really bothers a lot of us, the noise. Thank you for hearing me.
Thank you. Dr. Mitchell, if you can follow up with that situation and report back to the board, please. Next, we have LaDonna Guzman.
So most of you know I'm a teacher at Santana High School. I teach math, science, and the ASV group. So the reason that I'm here is because I teach my students to advocate for themselves, and I'm here advocating for our teachers. January 22nd, 2015 is a day I will never forget. I tripped on a cord in my classroom from a projector that was not mounted properly. Sorry. Coming back almost 6 months later after my injury, I came back to a classroom where the projector was still not mounted. And it took about a year for that to happen, which was really disappointing to me. And I know that my principal tried really hard, but thank you. But it didn't happen for about a year. So it was really hard for me. It's almost 2 years now. And while my projector is now mounted, the other teachers still have cords laying around their classes. We've been told over and over again that these projectors would be mounted properly for our safety. For my injury, I've gone through surgery. I've gone through painful injections. I have pain every day of my life now. I can no longer ride my horse. Or do several things that are very important to me. So I don't want this to happen to someone else because of these cords. Thank you. What I'm asking is, please, can someone look into this to find out why we cannot be safe at our school site? I saw Mr. Edmonds almost trip over a cord during the staff meeting from the same cords that injured me. Something has to be done. We were told recently, October 6th, everything would be installed. I went to my colleagues today. It's not. So I don't know how long this is supposed to take, but please don't let someone else go through what I've gone through. That's all I ask. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Mitchell, if we can get someone out there as soon as possible to do an assessment, and if you can report back to the board. Thank you. Mr. Lohman, you may want to just stay up here. You're next.
Can I bring props?
Yes, you can bring props.
All right. Good afternoon, board, Dr. Mitchell. First off, as a government teacher, I want to say that I really appreciated hearing the debate that took place about the universal lunch program. It's an interesting debate to be having, so thank you for having that. So I have 3 minutes. I'll try to do three quick topics. First off, thank you very much for voting last month on a resolution to support Prop 55. So part of my goodies are I have some buttons that I'm going to distribute. If anybody else would like some, we have them. Prop 55 is not a new tax on anybody. It simply extends the current tax rate that the voters approved back in 2012. Since the passage of Prop 30 back in 2012, we're beginning to see resource-required maintenance. Maintenance, and you just heard a speech about that, is projected mounted projectors. Almost 2 years ago, one of our teachers, LaDonna, fell over some cords, and as of today, we still don't have them all mounted. I know that this is at the district level now, and I appreciate that. And I understand the contractors are out at school sites and they're looking to get this done quick. But so I'm cautiously optimistic that next month we'll be able to come back and report that they were installed. But 20 months is just simply too long. So finally, with the time I'd like to have left, I want to talk a little bit about the national teacher shortage. So what I'm talking about is not specific to Roland Unified, it's about the national teacher shortage. Since 2011, there's been a 35% decline in enrollment of teachers in new teacher preparation programs. Another issue is we have an 8% attrition rate. 8% of our teachers across the nation leave every year. When you look at other very high performing nations, that attrition rate is about half that, about 4%. And when you look at the why, and I'm going to leave the board with an article, I sent it to you guys digitally too, but I have some hard copies as well. But we look at the why, and it's pay is an issue in some parts of the country, but one thing we find is that once people are hired and they made the decision to teach, it's actually equally important to look at their working conditions. And it seems when they're doing these studies that the lack of autonomy in the classroom is becoming one of the biggest issues that's driving people away. I know myself, I got to teach today. I got to do something that I don't get to do very often. And I got to plan a lesson last night, got to teach for an hour. I didn't have very many restrictions, except not to do anything that would get us in trouble. but that flexibility was amazing. And I think that's why we get into teaching. And it's nothing that RUSD particular is doing, but when we look at just education on a national sense, how do we let teachers be teachers and move in that direction? And so with that, I will wrap up that I get within my 3 minutes. I will leave a hard copy of the news article for you to look at. If anybody else is looking, if you just go on the NPR website, it's called Frustration, Burnout, Attrition, It's Time to Address the National Teacher Shortage, and it's on the NPR website, a simple Google search. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lohman. Mr. Humphreys?
Okay, I'm Roy Humphreys. Most people already know I'm going to get down to the subject matter, and that is we all should know and realize that running a school district from the administrative sector is a business. And I must applaud Mr. Malcolm bringing the question about the situation with the apples and the Chromebooks, so forth. Why is that business efficient? There were a lot of people that would take exception to that, and thank you for asking the questions. And previously, 2 months ago, we had Ms. Evenkamp bring to Mr. Peterson, the head of the Bond Oversight Committee, who was giving a speech here, and asked about the frequency of meetings, so forth. And to find that compromises, and the persons who went to you for that particular purpose, compromises the autonomy and the independence of that committee, and those people should be resolving their issues among themselves. And failure to do that, if they circumvent that, then they need to resign. Okay. And Mr. Chin's comment last month on speaking to the people, we must remember, without the people, you don't have any money. And without the parents, you know what the process happens as far as the kids come first. So when you're thinking of, about what should be the first priority and so forth, it'd be a good to take a good look at that. And there's a movie out called Truth, 2015. It'd be good for everybody to see, take a good look at that. Dan Rather comes out and says, asking the questions, that is our business. And again, I want to applaud those who do stand up and ask the right questions, especially as far as agenda items. And to that point, we come to the academic attendance situation, so forth, for this on this current situation here for today, that you're being asked to approve your board people up there, where you have Miss Louie and Miss Rivas, $1,500 to go to Downey. Okay, now that's what's on the paper there. I did a little research on actually this situation is taking place in Sacramento, and it's $550, I believe, is the fee up there. And it's so comes to light with the Judy Nye situation where she's going to San Diego and wound up in New York City. And last but not least, and something I find tremendously egregious, is they have five people on there going to spend $1,200 a pop to go to China. Now, it's a super deal. Now, a week in China with, you've got to read the thing. I'll put it out to you if you want to see it. And what are they going there for? Why are you spending $1,200 on five people? And I understand that Mr. Chen here is he's not going to take a penny of that. He's going to spend his own money. And to you, I take my hat off to you. This is a tremendous waste of money. And if we don't have enough Chinese in this country to do whatever you think you need to do as far as the Chinese situation in the state of California, County of Los Angeles, and in this community, I find it particularly obscene. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Humphreys. Next, we'll go into our public hearing. We have a hearing on sufficiency of standards aligned instructional materials. We need to hold a public hearing to receive public input on the sufficiency or insufficiency to tongue twister, of instructional materials for students in grades TK through 12 as required by Education Code Section 60119. The hearing will be opened at 5:12 p.m. The hearing will close at 5:13 p.m. Next, we would like to go back, if it's the pleasure of the board, our representative from Nogales High School is now here. And if it's the pleasure of the board, I would like to allow her to speak. Okay? Okay, Lori.
I'm sorry for being late. I wasn't aware of the change. I just got notified by my vice principal. I'm sorry. Well, good evening to everyone, and Madam President, Superintendent Dr. Mitchell, members of the cabinet, and members of the audience. My name is Lauren Chimis, and I'm here tonight to represent Nogales High School. September was a great month for us all at Nogales. More clubs have began their advertising to help attract more people to join, and some, like Maltra, have been able to fully represent themselves during our 2016 Fall Sports Rally, which was on September 30th. Our school loved our Super Mario themed rally and the Spirit Week that we had leading up to the event. For everyone, the 30th was a very big day. It was not only our first rally, but it was also our Battle of the Tracks game. Our football team practiced long and hard to be able to take the win against Roland once again. The whole school is really proud of our football team and the fundraiser that Nogales and Roland teamed up to do. On our rivalry game, we came together to raise funds for the nonprofit organization Stop for Aiden. The event resulted in more awareness of pedestrian safety and donations to help this amazing cause. Our school has been able to do great other things, like win in our other sports, like girls tennis, boys water polo, girls volleyball, and cross country. We send a big congratulations to our boys water polo team, who won 20-5 against Pioneer High School, and the girls tennis team, who won 13-5 against Workman High School. We're happy and proud to have great results from these events, and now we're looking forward to even better ones for homecoming. The homecoming theme this year will be Mulan, and it will take place on the 28th for the halftime performance, and the dance will be on the 29th. Our ticket sales have already begun, and we have a lot of hype for the game, especially because AZU will be having a special surprise that no one will want to miss. Moving on, we have more activities for our senior class, like the senior wall, in which our nobles can come together to paint this year's DC theme on our temporary wall. Also coming up soon, the senior baby pictures, memories, and car pictures that the class of 2017 can submit to be featured in the yearbook. This is a fun way for seniors to create more memories for the last year at Nogales and to get a fun break from college applications that they will have to be worrying about. Luckily this year, our counselors were able to organize days where USC, UCLA, UC Riverside came to our school to give us advice on how to apply. This and the college workshops have been really helping for us to get ready to find a perfect school. Nogales isn't just offering help in college, but as well as help in life. With our new SERV program and other programs made along with this, our faith club is able to add more unity to our school on a personal level. Our school has events like the grand opening, Hidden to Latina movie night, the National Honor Society inauguration that are able to help keep our school together as a noble family. Nogales loves to share these types of events and always come together and always love to come together like they do in the online on the online newspaper that is up and ready for anyone to go ahead and read by simply logging on to our Nogales website. So if you like more information on what great things we're doing, you can just check it there. Thank you. And sorry again.
Thank you. Next, we'll go to our discussion and action items. Resolution for Red Ribbon Week. Red Ribbon Week. Adopt and proclaim October 23rd through 31st, 2016 as Red Ribbon Week, with this year's theme being YOLO, You Only Live Once, Be Drug Free. May I get a motion to accept the resolution for Red Ribbon Week, October 23rd through 31st? I have a motion by Donna Friedman.
I second.
I have a second by Ms. Ebbenkamp. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have a resolution for Week of School Administrator, a lot easier to pronounce. The board is being asked to adopt a resolution proclaiming October 9th through 15th, 2016 as Week of the School Administrator in recognition of the contribution that school administrators make to successful pupil achievement. May I get a motion to accept Week of the School Administrator from October 9th through 15th?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Ebbingham.
A second.
A second by Ms. Friedman. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have resolution sufficiency of standards aligned instructional materials for all students. Each year, the Rowland Unified School District Board of Education holds a public hearing to make a determination as to whether each pupil in each school has sufficient textbooks or instructional materials or both that are aligned to the content standards and are consistent with the content and cycles of the curriculum framework adopted by the State Board of Education in reading, language arts, mathematics, science, and history, social science. The definition of sufficiency provides that each pupil, including each English language learner, must have a standards aligned textbook or instructional materials or both to use in class and to take home. May I get a motion to accept the resolution for sufficiency of standards aligned instructional materials for all students?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Friedman.
Second.
A second by Mr. Chen. Any discussion?
I have one statement.
Mr. Malkin?
In that requirement, there's a list of very specific items that need to be present for physics, chemistry, biology, and earth sciences. And I just want to state that I checked and was assured that an inventory was done to make sure that those items were present. So.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We have a first read. This is a discussion item only for a first reading and review of new board policy 1311, civility policy. We are asking that the board receive for the first reading and review the new board policy 1311, civility policy. Any discussion? Thank you. Oh, Ms. Ebbingham?
I'd just like to make the comment that obviously we have one student here. A lot of times when we're doing our board comments and such, I just like to see that we're being good examples to our students, because we can all differ and disagree about things, but there's a right way to do it and there's a wrong way to do it. So that's my two cents worth.
Thank you.
Most of it's in there, but I might ask to add a phrase or two.
Okay. Thank you. Next, we have our San Gabriel Valley Co-op piggyback on RFP number 03-6.29.13 for the purchase of snack food products. May I get a motion?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Friedman.
Second.
A second by Mr. Chen. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have the San Gabriel Valley Co-op piggyback RFP number staple 01-6.30.14 for the purchase of staple food products. May I get a motion?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Friedman.
A second.
A second by Mr. Chen. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have the Downey Unified School District piggyback bid number 15/16-23 for the purchase of hot pizza delivery to school sites for student meals. May I get a motion?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Friedman.
A second.
A second by Mr. Chen. Any discussion? Mr. Malkin.
I was just thinking of the presentation we had earlier on nutrition services.
Remember whole
about
grain
the pizza and whole
all
grain.
The good stuff.
Oh, Pizza Hut has whole grain pizza.
Maybe they make it special for us.
Oh, okay.
Any additional comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have authorization to I apologize, I was not here at the start of the meeting due to a conflict in schedule, so I didn't mark that one off. My apologies. Next, we have change in board meeting date for the November 8th, 2016 board meeting. The board is being asked to discuss a change in schedule for the November meeting, which is currently scheduled for November 8th and coincides with Election Day. Should the board wish to change the date of the meeting as to avoid any conflicts with Election Day, it is recommended the meeting be moved to Monday, November 7th, 2016. May I get a motion? I have a motion by Ms. Ebbingkamp, second.
I second.
A second by Mr. Chen. Discussion? Ms. Friedman?
I was just going to say, I'd like to know what the public feels like. Have you heard anything, if we should change it or not?
Actually, it was community feedback that was the reason why we proposed the change, because people were wanting to stay home and watch the returns from the election.
And that's what I wanted to hear.
Yeah. Any further discussion? Good question.
I support the idea of changing to 7.
Okay. Alrighty then, so we have a motion to change the November board meeting to Monday, November 7th. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. So everybody mark that on your calendar.
Same time.
Same time. Same time, just Monday, November 7th. Regular time.
That's what I meant.
Next, we have our consent calendar. All matters listed under consent calendar are considered by the Board of Education to be routine or sufficiently supported by prior or accompanying reference materials and information not requiring additional discussion. They will be enacted by a motion as referenced below. There will be no separate discussion of these items prior to the time the Board of Education votes on the motion, unless members of the board, staff, or public request specific items be discussed, added to, or deleted from the consent calendar for separate action. Members of the public may request that a specific item be removed from the consent calendar by completing the written request to address the board form card and presenting it to the secretary of the board in accordance with Board Bylaw 9322. All consent items are indicated by the designation C after the title. May I get a motion to accept the consent calendar?
I move.
I have a motion by Ms. Friedman.
Second.
A second by Mr. Chen. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have an informational only report, and that is on conference attendance. And next, we go to board comments. And Ms. Friedman, you're first this month.
It was a very busy month, and I attended many, many things. So many wonderful things are happening at our district. Alvarado's back to school night was really nice. It was weird to be on campus after my children both going there and going to all the conferences when they were there a while back. I attended the ARE Rep Council meeting and spoke to the teachers and was really happy to welcome them and say thank you for all your hard work. Roland Heights Day at the fair was a lot of fun. We were on a float and throwing out beads to all these people, adults, kids, and they were so excited. At Roland Council PTA's back to school night, breakfast at Nogales High School, it showed off the campus and it was really nice. And we attended the CTA conference and learned a lot. I wish I knew some of that stuff when I was a teacher. A Nogales ribbon cutting ceremony was very special, and I was able to take a tour with two students taking us around. The tailgate party before the football game, Nogales versus Roland, was really interesting. Sacramento, I was in Sacramento and attended the California Association of Suburban School Districts. Talked about Proposition 55. Looks like it's ahead right now, but we're still doing a lot of phone banking, hoping that it will pass. I visited Roland Elementary and Villa Corta. They both had assemblies, and that was exciting. I went into every classroom, and wonderful teaching is going on in our district. Last night was the RHCCC meeting, and there were over 50 people in attendance. It was really crowded. And the last three I saved for, because they're really special, the college fair at Roland High School. There were students picking up, hey, I've done this for 20 years. And it was something so special, because there were all the sheriff's departments there, and the firemen and the highway patrol, and they were recognized. I mean, because of them, we're safe, and they do so much for us and put their life on the line all the time. And it was just spectacular. I really enjoyed being there. And lastly, this week, the Be Strong Live anti-bullying simulcast was going on at Roland High School I attended, where the students from the Link crew were watching it.
And I really highly recommend you go to YouTube to find, I tried to find what he said yesterday, what he said at the assembly, but I couldn't find it, but he's on there. His name is Nick Vujicic. I'm not sure how to say his last name. But he's a man that doesn't have any legs or arms. And the whole thing was about anti-bullying and talking about how he wanted to give up his life when he was very, very young. And how he asked the kids when one of the students had said, put your heads down and put your hands up. Close your fist if you've ever thought about taking your life. And like hundreds of kids had closed their fists. And then how many of you, all the questions that you heard, it was amazing. And he said, I want to let you know I love you. There's someone always there that cares about you. And I think that I wish all the high schoolers or all, everybody would see this video because he just was amazing. And he showed that we're all in this together. And when someone bullies you, walk away. Just keep going. Your life is so important. And they have this company, this Be Strong, they have a website that you can go to or actually an app and they can talk to any children. He said, right now, 24/7, call them. Someone there will be on your side. We have to stop it. And this was so good that he said in schools that he has attended, some principal said 4 months after he attended, the morale of the school had changed and all the bullying had stopped. And it's just highly recommend you see him. A real busy month, but a lot of fun. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Friedman. Mr. Chen?
I have a comment on the China trip we're going to attend. The trip is organized by College Board, and the name of the trip is Chinese Bridge. And the purpose of the trip is to bring K-12 educators and teachers from the United States all over, from other states to China, and learn about the teaching Chinese language. The reason I supported it, I support the idea of implement a Chinese immersion program to our district. Both of our neighboring district already implemented the Chinese immersion program many years ago, and that's very successful. And the kids from our district wants to take that immersion program for that as the reason to transfer to other state, other districts. So the Northern District has large population of Asian kids, and not only Asian families, and all type of families, they have the interest to learn foreign language, especially learn Chinese language and very young. So the neighboring district offered that about 5 years ago and 6 years ago, and one offered 3 years ago. So I think it's time for us to add that program to our district. So I support that. That's why I support the administrators and teachers from our district to visit China to learn more about that. That's the whole the reason for the purpose of the trip. And I went to that trip in 2010, and the same. I combined this with my personal business trip, so I did not claim any school district fund. And for this trip too, I'm going to China for this anyway. But I do support the this district to support the our administrators to attend that event and attend a trip to China to learn more about the education and bring it back and to help us. So that's the background of the trip and the explanation for why I not going to claim the school district fund for the trip myself. The other issue is I want to share the information I got from the community from the with Dr. Mitchell. One day I spoke with one of a high school kid and asked him how to get to school. He said, I walk. He said, okay, you take the bike. I said, I don't bike anymore because the bike stolen, and he had several bike in the campus got stolen. So I was very surprised, and so I shared with Dr. Mitchell. So I asked Dr. Mitchell to pay more attention and find out how the campus safety and wanted to see that happen. And this is premature to make any conclusion, but I did mention it to our superintendent for our campus security. And bike stolen from the campus is very serious. And he said that the brake got broken, and the bike was there, and some bikes is gone. So, and it happened several times already. So I have to learn more. Learn more about it, and I ask the kids how it happened and how many. And as in the meantime, I think our campus police and the district police need to pay more attention on that. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chen. Ms. Evancamp?
Well, school's in full swing again. Time for me to start visiting campuses. It's that month, and I usually start about now, and I keep going the whole year till I've been to every one. But I'll be reporting back about that in the future. I look forward to visiting some of our music classes with Mr. Lohman and Dr. Mitchell. We're gonna go visit some of the music classes because we're still working out some kinks, and we wanna make it the best program we can. And as with most things, it's not perfect at the beginning, but that is in my plan coming up. I was very pleased about the day at the fair. Some of the community members got together and formed a committee, all volunteers, and we put together a fabulous day, and I don't think there was anybody who went that didn't have a great time. Next year we'll really promote it, so now that we know what to do and what it's about. But it was a lot of fun, and we want to thank any of you who attended, you know, bought your certificate to enter. All that money went back to our kids for the Yellow Bus, and that was a fabulous thing. And you don't have to live in Roland Heights to utilize that. If you have relatives or friends that want to do it, they can. And donations will be taken all year round if you know anybody that would like to donate to the program. As mentioned, the Buckboard Days Parade is this Saturday. Oh, I'll be glad when the parade is done because it's a lot of planning. We have a nice parade this year. I think there are 67 entries. A lot of kids, a lot of bands, adult groups, you name it, we'll have it. And then the festival afterwards should be fun. This year in the parade we have the Shrine Clowns. So that's new for us. They're from Shriners Hospital. And they're just, somebody's frowning because I mentioned clowns. Didn't name it. I don't think they're the scary kind of one. And lastly, I wanted to ask Dr. Mitchell, if you could get some information to us about how we can become more aware of what the matching programs are throughout, you know, our businesses or in the district. I heard somebody, we got benefit of some matching funds, and maybe we would participate more and let the community know too. Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Ms. Evancamp. Mr. Walken?
Thank you. I'm going to divert a little bit on this one, and this is something I give a lot of thought to. And after listening to Mr. Lohman's comments about doing a lesson plan, and being able to do a lesson plan that he wanted to do, I feel is even more appropriate that I do this. So if you please be patient with me, I really worked on wordsmithing this, so I said that, so I said the right thing and not the wrong thing. I'm going to read this rather than give it, you know, ad lib. Just a few minutes ago, we received an item for information only, information report conference attendance. Items included in this section do not require approval, are not on the consent calendar, or are subject to any discussion. Today is an exception for me. Included in this report are travel expenses for four RUSD staff members to visit China under the 2016 Chinese Bridge delegation. I have concern about using RUSD funds for this travel. It is my understanding that this trip is a collaboration with the College Board and the Confucius Institute in China, also known as Haban. I am currently on the STC Foundation, a nonprofit that fosters and teaches community about Asian cultures and traditions. I have also called for and supported a Mandarin immersion program for many years. However, I have concern about the Confucius Institute and its desire to control the content of educational material. This belief is held also by the University of Chicago, whose professors were told how and what they can teach, as well as a neighboring school district who turned down considerable funding from this institute for a Mandarin immersion program due to similar concerns and outcry from the community. Any restrictions on educational content needs to be approached and reviewed in a very careful manner. I have spoken to several leaders in our Asian community who have mixed responses to this institute. It ranged from okay to we need to avoid them. Therefore, due to uncertainty that exists, I wanted to reflect in the minutes that although we received this document, it does not mean that I support the contents, specifically the travels to China under the Chinese Bridge, Chinese Bridge funding. I'd like to have that entered into the minutes. Secondly, this last weekend, I completed two more classes for my master's in governance. One class left, which is be thankful to get that done with in June. I attended this Service Center Council 1 CTA-NEA conference in Pomona that Shay Lohman coordinated. It was a fantastic conference, had great representation from elected officials, and they each gave a presentation on what they were doing to support education. And I want to say thank you for inviting, and it was a great conference. The Roland Key Club, I worked with them, and we completed two cleanups at the local parks in 110 degree weather. It was hot out there, but we cleaned up two local parks. Tailgate party for Nogales and Roland football, I thought was fantastic. And the Nogales ribbon cutting was really a great event to see that come to a closure for their construction. I've been busy attending and going to the meetings for the RCPTA, and I hope everybody here has bought a PTA membership. They have a membership drive going on right now. And the Pro Rodeo. All I can say is I'm speechless. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. Well, I have a video of Dr. Mitchell that's worth 2,000 words. For some reason, there's only two people on the stands out of about almost 800. And out of that, there was only two people dancing in the stands. One of them was our Dr. Mitchell. And the clown, I hate to say that word, that was in the center ring happened to notice her and invited her down into center ring. And from there, it got worse. She jumped over barrels, she ran an obstacle course, and pretty much helped another gentleman to go through the course that was having difficulties for the eye protection that he had on. But I have to say, people around me wanted to know who she was. And I was really proud to say she's our superintendent. So thank you for that, and you made me proud of Roland that you went down there and did that. And lastly, Buckboard Parade tickets for pancakes if anybody wants them, $5. And we'll have them at the Bell Memorial over here. Oh, I guess somebody wants to buy the video. Maybe I should auction it off for charity. I never thought about putting it on YouTube. That's all I have. Oh, one other thing, the ASB from Santana, I really commend her for when she said that the new students arrived and they showed, and the ASB students showed the new student around. And it just takes me back to what I was saying earlier in an earlier meeting. Peer counseling is so important, especially at that age group. And to see the peers helping peers out, I think is the way to go. And I really think that if we can expand that philosophy in all the schools, it would be a win-win for everybody. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Malkin. Usually my board comments are like
60 seconds. Tonight, you guys are going to have to bear with me for a little bit longer than that. I'll try to keep it short, though, still. First, I want to say that the Nogales ribbon cutting was a very nice event, and a good time was truly had by all. And I want to give a special thank you to Gina Ward for all her hard work with that event. I had a great time. And the college fair, as Ms. Friedman said, was just fantastic. It was hosted, it's a district college fair. This year was hosted by Roland High School. They did a really good job setting, I was there from the beginning when they were setting up and organizing everything, and it was fantastic. Very, very well attended with some really excellent state and out-of-state universities represented. The students and their parents were very pleased with the colleges that participated. I've been to a college fair from a neighboring district, and they had nowhere near what we had at this fair, so great job on that. I'm sorry I missed the Battle of the Tracks game. I heard it was great, though, and that the tailgate was fantastic, so congratulations to Nogales on their victory. I did, however, make the Thursday game of the freshman Battle of the Tracks between Roland and Nogales freshman team. So I did get to support one of the football games, and that was a good game as well. The other thing I wanted to address is the Chinese trip China trip issue. I'm sorry, I'm tongue-tied today. A lot of people may not be familiar with College Board. If you don't work in education, I really don't expect many people to be familiar with College Board. But College Board has been around since 1899, and they are the primary, they're the agency who runs the standardized test for college entrance. So if your kid's going to take the SAT, they go through College Board. I work at a community college. I have attended a number of events hosted by College Board as an educator at the community college level. And all of their events have actually been the conferences that were probably the most beneficial to me over the years. And I've been at Mount SAC now for almost 20 years. So they're a very solid organization and very, very good organization to work with. They come out to the college. They do training for everybody, and it's a really good thing. But to address the China trip, we have looked at, as Mr. Chin said, we're considering starting a dual immersion program. And that is the, someone asked in public comments, what is the purpose of this? That is the purpose of this, is to go over there to get information, to bring it back, and decide how to move forward on our dual immersion program. If you look at the individuals who are attending, you'll see that it's a mix of teachers, administrators that are going over there to look at the programs and educational system so that we can make sure that we develop a solid program from the start that is going to be superior to those that are offered by our neighboring districts. I want to make very, very clear that this is not a vacation. There's a lot of talk that went into this before we even submitted our applications. And some of the things that we dialogued about was, what do we want to find out before we go over there? So questions were actually put out to College Board saying, what are we going to do? Who are we going to talk to? What are we going to see? I just want to share a few items with you regarding what we'll be doing while we're over there. And there's going to be representatives in our group from California, Utah, and Nevada that are going, all educators from K through 12 school districts. And then as far as our itinerary goes, our hosts are actually educators themselves. We have Mr. Montoya, who's about 10 hours to recover from the flight before we are off to visit, have our orientation, and we have a guest lecturer on the education system in China. And they said that they will be covering all aspects of the education system, not just one. They will talk to us about all the different education systems that they have, because they do have various types. Then we will be visiting a university, and before we break out to go visit different regions. So while some people in our group may go to one region, other people in our group will go to a different region. That way we can get a full view of what's going on with their educational system and what things we can bring back as best practices as we get ready to implement a dual immersion program. We'll also do some cultural visits in respective regions before we travel back to Beijing. The one thing we will get to do that will be fun is see the Great Wall of China. So yes, there, I guess there is like a half a day of vacation in there. And then we will have breakout sessions and educational forums so that all of the people participating, those from California, Utah, Nevada, can share their experiences, what they learned, what they saw, how they're going to implement things, and how they're going to utilize this information once we return. Before we leave, those of us who are going will be meeting to again go over our goals and objectives and have a solid plan so that as we break off and we are sent to different regions, everybody's looking at the same types of things and asking the same types of questions so we can really make sure that we're benefiting from this in the, you know, fully. Now, I know this program has been going on in our district for several years. There are several people who have attended here in our districts from previous superintendents, previous administrators, previous teachers, etc. I cannot say what the previous purposes were for. The reason we talked about it was strictly because we are looking to implement this dual immersion program. So when people make assumptions about this and about what we're doing, they're usually wrong. And if you ask us, we're happy to share the information with you. And one of the other things I want to say is about the cost. The cost is very, 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 very cheap. Actually, when they sent the flight information, I was curious. You know, I went online, looked up that flight to see how much the ticket would cost if I paid for it myself. And I assure you, it was way more than what is reported for our small portion for this trip. Everything is paid for by College Board. That is who funds the trip, is College Board. They are the ones who put up the money for it. Do they work with agencies in China? Of course they have to. That would be no different if somebody came up, when the people come over here from China, there's an agency here that they work with as well. So yes, they work with other agencies, but we are not going there to sign any documents with any schools. We're not going over there to buy curriculum from them. We're going over there to learn about their educational systems, their best practices, what works, what doesn't. And just last week, I had the opportunity to have a group dinner with, I was sharing with Dr. Mitchell, a group with of Asian parents who are very excited that we're looking into this program. Has people have bad experiences in China that lived there previously? Yes, but most of them still want their children to have that educational system that many of them had. So I'm looking forward to it. I think this is going to be a great benefit to our district, and I think that the cost is well worth it. And I think that the mix of individuals that we have who will be attending is a very solid team. With that said, I will move on to my very last comment. And this is another one that may not be too fun to say, but for those of you who may have watched the debate, the presidential debate the other night, there was a parent, a teacher who asked one of the first questions, and one of the things she said was, how do we as educators allow our students to watch debates as homework when we don't know what's going to be said and we're afraid of what they may hear, you know, that's going on in these debates? I remember when I was in school, there was elections, we had to watch the debates. That was homework, and we had to write a little summary about it. If I had a young child now, would I have allowed them to watch the debate? No. But that takes me to the public comments that we receive here at the board. While everyone has the right to come to the board meeting and give their public comments, people should not have the right to be slanderous, to be rude, and to be inappropriate during board comments, especially as Ms. Ebenkamp earlier stated, when we have students sitting here in the room, which several students were very, called me and were very upset and offended by some things that were said during public comments at the last meeting. So I would just like to respectfully ask that any individual who wants to make a public comment, please do so in a professional manner, and keep in mind that our students are here in this room and that our students do hear what you say, and not all of them think it's funny. Many of them are offended by it. With that, I would like to say with that, I would like to say, I hope you guys enjoy getting home early tonight. I know I am. Unfortunately, we do have a little bit more business to take care of, so the board will be adjourning back to closed session before we adjourn the meeting. But to all of you guys, have a very good night.
How you doing?